everybody, and thanks for joining our weekly podcast. I'm Robin Lewis, founder and CEO of The Robin Report, which, by the way, is much more than a daily report, okay? It really is a knowledge platform from which we communicate thought leadership on various strategic topics through our, yes, daily reports, but also these podcasts, also some webinars, and hopefully live events down the road a little bit. And along with our chief strategist, Shelley Kohan, who's also a professor at FIT and Syracuse University, we welcome you to our conversation on the 2022 Holiday Spending Predictions Report. And we are very fortunate and honored, really, to have an expert in data analytics, Andy Mantis, president of Commerce Signals, a TransUnion company. So Andy, first of all, thanks so much for joining our podcast once again. And, you know, why don't you take us through a quick overview of what we're going to be doing here?
Sounds good. And first, Robin and Shelley, thanks for having me on. Always great to speak with you. And by way of a little bit of update and context, since we last spoke, Commerce Signals, which formerly had been owned by Verisk, was sold to TransUnion. We're very, very excited to be part of the TransUnion family. Still early stages, but a wonderful fit. And as you guys know, at Commerce Signals, we have a vast amount of anonymized and permissioned consumer card data. You know, and what we're able to do is uniquely take that data and organize it into both wallet and household views. We have data on over 40 million households, but if you think about it, most people have more than one credit card in their wallet. We're able to harmonize that so it can fit a true wallet view. And what we do is we work with our customers on a few things. One, competitive insights, right down to a store level. Models for digital audiences that are used for targeting in marketing campaigns. Campaign measurement, where our data is used for attribution. So those who are exposed to a campaign, well, did they actually spend? We can see that. And then finally, spend depends. Again, we model and help augment things like CRM files. And today, I'm thrilled to take you through our holiday forecast, what we expect coming up for the balance of the year.
It's so exciting. And of course, we know consumer spending data is actually really powerful truth set. You know, as retailers kind of grow their business and create these competitive advantages, by they're trying to amass as much data as possible, but it's really important to focus on the right data, right?
Yep. You know what? You're absolutely right, Shelley. Spend data is where they're voting with the wallet. It is election day and consumers consumers are voting with their wallet. And I think when we get into the holiday spend forecast, you'll see by where we believe people will spend, how it's not necessarily 100% intuitive. And the wallet and the spend view includes emotional drivers of where you actually place your money.
You know, Andy, and you and Commerce, I have to say this before we get into this, you and Commerce Signal have really dug into those wallets like nobody else. And accordingly, you have created this holiday spending forecast using that data. And of course, we're fortunate enough to have you share it with us. So take it away. Maybe start with a, you know, overall view.
Sure. Yeah, let's start at the top line. And first, for the holiday period, what we define that is the week of Thanksgiving through the week of Christmas.
Thank you.
If we had a crystal ball, maybe we should have started earlier since the discounting began in October. But for this prediction, set of predictions, it's that period of time. And overall, we expect consumer card spend to be up 11% year over year. Now, Considering that inflation has been up in the realm of 8%, you know, overall that's a little bit of a marginal increase. But you know, the top level really doesn't tell it all. The real story emerges when we start looking at the difference between discretionary and non-discretionary spend, right? Mm-hmm. So you can't get away from headlines on inflation, and that's for good reason. And a lot of your non-discretionary spend has been impacted by inflation. For example, we expect spend on fuel to be up, you know, and that's at the pump, to be up 33% year over year. Utilities up 16% year over year. And those are two categories where you can't really, most people can't make trades. You know, they're either driving to work, you know, you've got your utilities, and inflation is really impacting the consumer in those dimensions. Now, mm-hmm. another part of non-discretionary spend would be grocery or food. That we are only expecting to see a 3% year over year increase. Mm-hmm. Say, well, why is that? People are trading down. They're either putting fewer items in the basket or they're trading down to generics or cheaper items. You know, earlier this year in the summer, we did a report specific to inflation, and we could already see that trade down starting. And we could also see at that time greater discretionary spend than we're seeing now. So, you know, again, starting with the non-discretionary, a lot of people don't have a choice. It's taking up more of their wallet. Income is not keeping up with inflation, and where they can trade down, people are doing that. Okay. So flipping from, go ahead, Shelley.
No, go ahead. I was going to jump into, well, first of all, thanks for the trading down. That's an interesting conversation. Rob and I have been talking a lot about this topic. So that's great for private label brands and store brands. Doing well drives deeper loyalty. But if we could talk a little bit about something that's coming up in a couple of weeks, I can't believe that those words are coming out of my mouth. Black Friday is just around the corner. And I hear rumor on the street has it that shoppers are actually going to be returning to physical stores. And many are really looking forward to the whole socialization of going out shopping on Black Friday. So, and you know, this holiday is really going to be the most normal since the pandemic. So tell us, Andy, what's your forecast expecting from Black Friday this year?
Sure. For Black Friday specifically, we're expecting an increase of 16%. And Shelley, you're spot on. We believe the driver is going to be people are going back into stores, even though they're not necessarily opening on Thanksgiving Day anymore, the same rate, but people are going back into the stores. And then, you know, following that up with Cyber Week, we do expect online sales to increase 14%, but historically you would have expected the ratio of Black Friday to cyber weeks to have been different, with Cyber Week growth outpacing. So you can see that store aspect is catching up. And then we're only around for Cyber Week expecting omni-channel sales to grow about 6% year over year. So there is definitely a behavioral shift coming about from, you know, I think, like that pent up desire to get back out there a bit.
Yeah, you know, that 16% up for Black Friday, it sounds like consumers are not really slowing down in terms of spending, but maybe looking for the deals. And it's also interesting to see such a large increase with Black Friday deals really having started in October.
Right.
I mean, many believe that retailers starting early are really pulling sales out of November into October. But based on the spending forecast, November sales will be robust and not greatly impacted by inflationary pricing and rising interest rates. So, and the total holiday being up 10.4%, according to the forecast, obviously will be music to the ears of many retailers and brands. I mean, most of the forecasts that I've seen, like NRF, they say retail will be up between 6% and 8%. So your forecast, Andy, is much more optimistic, and we like optimism.
Yeah, well, it's so, optimistic, but not equal. So, you know, if you go back to the premise that people, because of inflation, they have a little bit less discretionary income. And you say, where is it going? And, you know, we talked a little bit about retail, but that's not the only place discretionary income can go. And it's the big growth is actually in travel and entertainment. So it is, you know, I mean, the real story here is, you know, a return to in-person experiences, travel and entertainment. And even though there's definitely price, prices are going up in areas like airfare, we expect air to be up 49% year over year.
Wow.
Now, that said, we also see evidence of trading. So some of the discount airlines, you know, are doing a little bit better. But again, if people are voting with their wallet, they're voting to get out and travel very clearly with discretion, with their discretionary income. And we're expecting hotel to be up 29% year over year. So, you know, that's one aspect to it, right? So you've got, we had that non-discretionary taken up a chunk, then discretionary travel's taken up a big chunk. And then we see restaurants and bars growing 25% year over year, which is okay. I don't know about you guys, but I'm starting to get out a bit and I'm really happy about it. And I think everything from family gathering to friends to, you know, even potentially work stuff, in person is coming back. So that then leaves us with, you know, where we were talking about of, well, optimism for retailers, but definitely not equal. I can go into that if you'd like. You want me to break down how we see retail standing out?
Yeah, give us some retail categories.
You know, if you go back, like, you know, during the height of the pandemic, you would have, you know, like home improvement, you'd have crafts, you'd have those categories just booming. Let's go with the negative and then we'll move to the positive. You know, like, unfortunately, we believe clothing's going to be down about 3% year over year. Even with some people getting back to the office, it's not fueling clothing. Home goods stores, which had been booming, and including home centers, we also think are going to be down between 3 and 4%. Sporting goods, hobby stores, down close to 3% year over year. So, you know, in some of those areas that were booming in the height of COVID, they're now not going to perform year over year at the same level. Now, they did have some pretty big bump ups during COVID, but, you know, they're going to suffer a bit. You contrast that with where there should be more optimism. We believe department stores are going to be up 11% year over year, which is pretty very healthy.
That's amazing. Yeah.
Still got inflation in there at around 8%, but still they're outpacing inflation, which is pretty good. Then you would have electronics, which will keep, you know, pace with inflation at around 8%. And then some of the others, you know, like discount stores where, you know, again, some of the shoppers there just will have less discretionary income available, will still increase by about 4%. And actually, surprisingly to us, hardware stores, we think they're going to be up 10% year over year. So, you know, it's not everyone's going to be a winner, but overall, I'm glad to hear we have a little bit more optimistic view than some others.
It's interesting that clothing is going to be down a little over 3%, yet department stores are going to be up almost 12%, and they're so reliant on clothing.
I know.
Part of their.
Yep. Yeah. We Yeah, and I don't know, maybe that's the variety. You know, we're thinking a lot of the specialty is going to suffer more, and the multi-category department stores with much more breadth of variety are just going to do better.
The other interesting number that was in your report is you call it wholesale retailers are going to be up almost 19%. Can you tell us a little how you define wholesale retailers and maybe about that number?
Yeah, I can unpack that a little bit. That'll make it a little bit more intuitive. That's a combination of, for example, you'd have your wholesale clubs in there and you would see two things going on. One, you're talking about discounting and value. I think they're going to get a disproportionate share of discretionary spend because of their price point. And then, you know, some of the things that we do have mixed in there, you know, they do a little bit of travel and some other things, even eye care, et cetera, at some of them, which are definitely, you know, will help push those numbers up. But you can think of those, you know, to a large degree of your Costco's, your Sam's Clubs, et cetera.
PJ's,
yeah.
Yep. And, you know, when you're potentially headed toward an economic downturn, you know, sometimes they can do well. And they're also less reliant than the pure discount stores on lower income demographics. You know, these days, the wholesale clubs have a huge span of purchaser.
Definitely.
Also, I think that they all offer gas pumps, don't they?
Or at least they do.
Yeah, they do.
That's a good point, Robin.
Yeah. Well, good for me.
Compared to the major fuel companies, you know, they're not as large, but yeah, you know, like if you'll even take a look at the earnings reports of some of them, you know, the Costco's of the world, they will, you know, the analysts will try and break that out. To understand inflation-driven fuel revenue versus their other revenue. And they typically don't have the same margins in fuel. And so for obvious reasons, that's an area an analyst would want to dissect.
Definitely. Well, I want to go back to something I found most fascinating in the report was what you mentioned earlier about the airline and the travel. Yeah. And it looks like, based on your report, that consumer travel spending is going to be back to pre-pandemic levels this year. So a couple points on that. You mentioned that travel spending is going to increase by 32%, and it's 79% higher than 2020, which is just, it's
amazing.
Such a large amount. You mentioned the airline fees. Is part of this the rising fuel cost? And how does this travel spend, can it positively affect other areas of retail?
So there are a few different effects. So one is, and part of it is driven by, you know, the airlines just are charging more right now. You know, I think, but what we see is it's not, even though prices are going up, it's not impacting to a large degree people's desire to travel, right? People are still getting out there, hence the increase. But Shelley, what you will see is a really nice halo effect for destinations and places that are catering to tourism. So again, you know, we see like restaurants going way up, you know, your restaurants, entertainment, potentially different tourist types of attractions. But, you know, any time a local economy is going to benefit from an influx of travelers, they're going to benefit. And that's also very welcome because, again, you go back, you know, you mentioned 2020, all of those people who relied and those economies that relied on a contribution from travelers were just, you know, I mean, it was dismal. And, you know, it's really welcome that it's coming back. We even see, and it's not in the holiday report, just we do work with a fair number of tourism associations. What we do is, you know, I mentioned we do campaign measurement. We actually are able to measure if you're like I love New York and you're doing a campaign to get people to come into New York, we can measure the impact of that campaign on the local economy. And we're seeing all across the country more and more activity in that area. So I think that's, you know, to your question, hopefully a nice halo effect on various local economies.
You know, Andy, another thought came to mind, which I know I was talking to somebody, an investment firm, CEO of an investment firm. I wonder if the increase in tourist traffic, you know, in terms of airlines, that increase, I wonder if it's going to be offset by a much declined business travel. And that, I think, I don't quantify it, but a lot of that was caused by people getting used to working from home and virtually. And this investment guy I was talking to said, Robin, you won't believe, we can save probably $750,000 a year not having to travel around the world, you know. So I think that's another factor that may be very interesting.
Yeah.
I don't know if you have anything on that or not.
Well, we focus on consumer, not business,
Well, that's right. Yeah.
Yeah, but I absolutely agree with you for a couple of reasons. One is, not only have people gotten used to, you know, being on their Zoom calls, but also, many companies are just going into 2023 with a more cautious view based on some economic uncertainty. And one of the controllable expenses for many large companies is travel and entertainment.
Yeah.
So you would expect that. But my sense is, that would not, you know, I'll give you a couple of, you know, other qualitative aspects. One, we do see conferences back in person, by and large, right? So I don't know if you went to Shop Talk, you know, et cetera. CES is back in full swing coming up in January. So there will be, you know, hubs and events for corporate business travel, even if it's overall less. But I just think that, you know, man, that steep cliff of consumer travel that, in my sense, impacted more employment and economies across the country, you know, will I think that benefit will outweigh some of the trade-off. An opinion, not based on data.
You know, another thing, Andy, that Shelley and I have been talking about, actually writing about a little bit as well, is how forecasting is so difficult these days because there really is no historical reference. I mean, as we all know, the conversation always starts like, how did we do last year in XYZ category, et cetera, which was totally disrupted by the pandemic. So I'm sure there are many considerations that go into the methodology. But can you briefly cover how you create this forecast? I'm sure our listeners would like to understand the methodology at a high level.
Absolutely, not to be flip with some very, very smart data scientists, but with the methodology, we're using 3 years of historic consumer spend data with weight given to the more recent time periods. But what we've added in this year are a couple things. One, a much more advanced view of inflation. So not only the consumer price index, but forecasted inflation. So not only are we putting in forecasted inflation, we've been updating this. We will update it on a monthly basis. So we did our original runs of the data in September. And then, you know, literally 2 weeks ago, we finished an October update based on some higher, based on September's actual inflation, not our projected, and then the forecast for the rest of the year. And what we found is, you know, even though, you know, we were updating our numbers, it was frankly just marginal changes. So, Rob, well, you're absolutely right. It's hard to have a crystal ball. We think that, you know, data on, you know, 40 million households updated monthly with some pretty sophisticated models and history has a good shot at getting it right. We'll see.
Yep. And I was just thinking of today being election day. Boy, nobody knows what the outcome of anything's going to be. Crazy. But, you know, Andy, as usual, with you, we learn new ways of looking at things, and we learn a lot. And the one major message our audience should take away from this awesome conversation is that Commerce Signals goes deep into analyzing consumers' wallets and can calculate insights that I believe are truly unique. And I've been around for a while and I've seen a lot of these different solutions. So Andy, thanks so much again. And I suggest that our audience should reach out to you to determine how you can add, I think, enormous value to their efforts. So anyway, accordingly, please tell our listeners how they can reach you or Commerce Signals.
Sure. Thanks, Robin and Shelley. And, you know, and again, yeah, you know, data is only as good as what you do with it. And our mission is to help our customers make more informed and effective decisions, be they in marketing effectiveness or operational decisions. Look, coming into next year, we believe we can help with even store footprint decisions if things get tough in the economy. And can always reach out to me, even though we have a new parent company, the emails have not changed. It's andrew.mantis, M-A-N-T-I-S, at verisk.com, and be thrilled to speak with anyone.
Great, Andy, it's always so much fun having you here and helping us to explain what's happening in the industry. So thank you for that. And for our listeners, you can find more of our podcast on Apple, Spotify, Buzzsprout, and of course, therobinreport.com. And look for us on YouTube, where we broadcast our podcast as well. And make sure to follow us on social media, link in with us for the latest thoughts about the industry.
And I want to thank everybody again. And as I say every week, if any of you out there has a topic that you've been thinking about and would like Shelley and I to cover at some point, just reach out to me at robin@therobinreport.com. And thank you again.